Hey, how you doing? Can you hear me fine? Is it sound bad? Good? Is it staticky at all? At anything like that? Okay, good.
There's honey in the rock, water in the stone, manna on the ground, no matter where I go. I don't need to worry now that I know everything I need you got. There's honey in the rock. Praying for a miracle, thirsty for the living word. Only
worship with us?
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken, and I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Is devoted like a ring of solid gold, like a vow that is tested, like a covenant of old. Your love is enduring through the winter rain and beyond the horizon, with mercy for today. Faithful you have been, and faithful you will be. You pledge yourself to me, and it's why I sing. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your kindness makes us whole, and you shoulder our weakness, and your strength becomes our own. Now you're making me like you, clothing me in white, bringing beauty from ashes, for you will have your bride, free of all her guilt, and rid of all her shame. And known by her true name, and it's why I sing your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. You will be praised, you will be praised. With angels and saints we sing, worthy are you, Lord. You will be praised, oh, you will be praised. With angels and saints we sing, worthy. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips.
Crushing, in the pressing, you are making new wine. In the soil I now surrender, you are breaking new ground. So I yield to you into your careful hand. When I trust you, I don't need to understand. Make me your vessel, make me an offering, make me whatever you want me to be. Lord, I came here with nothing, but all you have given me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. In the crushing, in the pressing,
you were making new wine. In the soil I now surrender, you were breaking new ground. You were breaking a new ground. So make me your vessel. Make me an offering. Make me whatever you want me to be. Lord, I came here with nothing but all you have given me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Where there is new wine, there is new power, there is new freedom. The kingdom is here. I lay down my old flames to carry your new fire today. Cause where there is new wine, there is new power, there is new freedom. The kingdom is here. I lay down my old flames to carry your new fire today. So make me your vessel. Make me an offering. Make me whatever you want me to be. God, I came here with nothing but all you have given me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me.
Good evening, everyone. I hope y'all can hear me. I'm wearing Chris's mic, and I don't want to adjust it or change it, so it's running down my jawline. I'm that guy that when I get into a truck or a vehicle that belongs to somebody else, I don't want to adjust their seat. I just don't want to do it. I don't know. I feel like it's disrespectful. So I don't want to adjust his mic, so hopefully y'all can hear me just fine. The girls did amazing. Can we give them another hand? I am so proud of them. I mean, you think about it, it takes a lot of courage to be in high school, standing up here singing in front of everyone, in front of their friends, in front of adults. It's intimidating if you're an adult, much less a teenager, and I think they did amazing. They kind of beat themselves up sometimes, and they give me looks like, oh no, did I sing that part right or do this right? Y'all did amazing. Y'all did amazing. If you notice, today looks a little bit different than most Sunday nights. We had more singing. I'm not wearing a suit or nice clothes. I'm wearing a t-shirt, as well as the girls were. We have some props and stuff up here. This service is going to be a little different. It's kind of going to have the vibe we do at Taunton's. And that's why I thought, hey, it'd be perfect to wear our Taunton's mission shirt. When we go to Taunton's, that's our, for those of y'all don't know, that's our student trip we go on once a year, where we go down to Florida. There's a Taunton's children's home there. We help them do whatever they need. We work there, we build stuff, we love on their kids, because it's an orphanage, and we love on those kids that are there, but we get to have church. We get to have singing and worship, we get to be real and authentic. So tonight, the service is going to look a little more like that, and I encourage a lot of the teens to come. We're going to have, I'm going to ask questions randomly, and I'm going to ask y'all questions, and I would like answers. Just shout it back at me, you know, if you know them. We're going to have demonstrations. I might even get a volunteer or two, so I may pluck you out of the crowd, you know. So, you know, those of y'all sitting in the back, don't worry, you're not safe. I think we're going to have fun tonight. I think we're going to, for those of y'all that are in here, if we sit here in the pew with an open heart, God, give me something today, I guarantee you, you're going to get something from this. I guarantee it. All joking aside, all fun aside, if you say, God, I'm here to get something, show me something, guarantee you he will. We just have to come to him with an open heart. So today, we're going to be in Romans chapter 12, and we're going to read verses 1 and 2. My students that are in here, they may recognize that verse. That is our motto verse when we went to Florida. That was our verse we put on our shirts. That was the verse that we formed our whole week by, was Romans 12, 1 and 2, those two verses. But today, I'm going to preach a different sermon than what I preached there on this verse. It's going to have the same undertones for those students that were there of that verse, of that sermon, but I think it has something new and relevant that we all need to hear, not only the students, but the adults in here. I think we need to hear it, because I think sometimes we get stuck in our mind and get stuck in a rut of doing the same thing day in and day out in our life and in church, and there's so much more to that life than what we're doing. So we're going to be in Romans chapter 12. We're going to read verses 1 and 2. If you would, please stand for the reading of God's word. Romans 12, verse 1 says, "Therefore, brothers and sisters, in view of the mercies of God, I urge you to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true worship. Do not be conformed to this age, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you may discern what is good, pleasing, and the perfect will of God." Let me pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for all your many blessings. Lord, thank you for each and every person that came out tonight. Lord, I pray that you just give somebody, give them something special. Lord, each person in here, Lord, speak to them in their own way. Lord, I pray if there's anyone in here that's lost, that they'll surrender their life to you today. Lord, I pray that your perfect will be done. I pray that you speak through me, push me aside, Lord. I don't want them to hear Jake. Lord, I want them to hear Jesus. Lord, I pray that your perfect will be done tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Y'all can be seated. So the title to my message, whenever we were in Taunton's, my title was Got Changed. That was a theme on our verse. The title to my message is, Are You Changed or Just Rearranged? Are you changed or just rearranged? My first point to this message is, what does salvation talk like? What does salvation talk like? So I say we all. What do you think somebody who's saved should talk like? Give me an answer. What do you think it should talk like? Spit it out. Should they talk like the world? Should they cuss? Should they say inappropriate jokes? Should they say that? Yes, no, maybe. Getting no's from the students. All right. So they don't talk like the rest of the world, right? What about how do they act? How do they act? Give me some examples of somebody who's saved, how they act. Kindness. With kindness, okay. Compassion. Compassion, right? Grace, obviously, right? We're given grace, so we give grace, right? Those are all good answers. Now, I want you to ask yourself internally, do I represent those answers? Does my life look like I talk like I'm saved? Do I talk like the world? Do I act like I'm saved? Do I act like the world? Now, I don't just mean in front of certain people. I mean, do I act like I'm saved when I'm by myself? Do I act like I'm saved when I'm at church? Do I act like I'm saved when I'm on the football field? Do I act like I'm saved when I'm at my school, in the locker room with my coworkers? Do I act like I'm saved when I'm alone with my girlfriend or boyfriend? Do I act like I'm saved? How do you act? You say, "Well, I don't know how to do all that. I don't know exactly what acting or talking like a Christian looks like." Well, we're going to give you prime examples of what talking and acting and looking and walking like a Christian looks like through Scripture. We're going to give it to you so you can be like, "Oh, there's the roadmap to what God says we need to act like." Now, when I first got saved, it was exciting for me. I mean, it was full of excitement, tears, emotion. Most people are that way when they get saved. It's an emotional experience. You know, like you're just ready to charge hell with an empty water pistol. Like, rip me out the plastic, I'm brand new. God, whatever you need me to do, I got them in the front. Whatever you need me to do, I can do it, God. Whatever you need me to do, right? Just give me something. Whatever you need me to do, I'm here, right? I mistakenly and thought that all my friends were going to be excited for me like the angels were excited for me in heaven. I thought they were going to throw a party for me like they threw a party for me in heaven when I got saved. But what happened? I got around my friends, my coworkers. You're not going to believe what happened to me. I got saved. And they were like, "Oh, okay, cool. So you're going to come to this party this weekend or what?" Like, no excitement, did not care. It did not faze them in the least bit. In fact, they were a little bit upset with me. They're like, so what does this mean? You're better than us? What does this mean? You're not going to come to the parties with us anymore? Jake, are you a Bible thumper now? You a holy cookie? Huh? Like, I was like, are you guys serious? It was exactly the opposite. And then they started, hey, well, that's cool. Well, let me tell you this joke I heard the other day, this inappropriate joke. And then right there in that moment, I had to decide, am I going to talk like the rest of the world? Am I going to be privy to those jokes like everyone else at my workplace? Am I going to partake in those jokes? Am I going to say those things? Or am I not? And I remember being a young Christian, and I was, it sounds crazy now to think about it, but I was conflicted. God, what's right? What do I do? Is it okay to say those words? Is it okay to say those jokes? Is it okay to be around that stuff? And I opened my Bible and I said, God, show me what I need to do. And he directed me to Ephesians. Let me find it real quick. I'll read it for you. Ephesians 4:29. And Ephesians 4:29 says this, no foul language should come out of your mouth, but only what is good for building up of someone in need, so that it gives grace to those who hear. So I was like, okay, well, I'm not supposed to cuss. Check. God says that very clearly. But then he takes it a step further and he says, you shouldn't be saying things that tear people down. Because I had a problem with being that guy that had to be funny and tear people down all the time. Like that was me. That's what I did. So I'd make fun of people and tear them down. And I read that scripture and I was like, oh, I'm not supposed to gossip. I'm not supposed to tear people down. I'm not supposed to make fun of people for jokes around everybody laughing at the workplace. That's not what I'm called to do. I'm supposed to be building people up and encouraging them and loving them. So when I see someone who's saved, someone who has received salvation and truly surrendered, when they receive that salvation, they may not change the way they talk immediately. Their speech may not change immediately. They stubbed their toe a week after they got saved. You don't know what's coming out of their mouth, right? They may not change immediately, but they have an immediate desire to change. They're immediately convicted about the words they're saying and what they're doing and what they're talking about, right? They know it's wrong. So there's an immediate desire. God, show me. God, forgive me for what I said. God, forgive me for doing that. God, help me not to do that anymore. So what does salvation talk like? They talk like Jesus. They build people up. They're not running around tearing people down, gossiping. They're not making fun of people. And one thing I noticed about, and this is a side note, it's not really about talking, but one thing I noticed about somebody who received salvation most of the time, now we all have a little bit of our pride in us, but most of the time they're a whole lot more humble than they were before. I was humbled a lot because I had to humble myself before Christ to surrender my life to him. For the longest time, I knew all about the Bible. You could ask me questions. I had preachers come to my house and say, Jake, do you know if you were to die today where you'd spend eternity? Lost as all get out, I'd go to heaven. Really, how do you know? Through the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. Ha, gotcha. Well, are you certain? Absolutely. Lying to their faces. I could quote scripture. I grew up in church since I was 2 weeks old. I was in church. Lost as all get out. What happened was I wanted to be Lord of my life so I wouldn't surrender my life. Finally, I had enough of the addictions and enough of the drinking and enough of the partying, and I was done trying to fix my own marriage, and I said, God, I can't do it. I have to humble myself before you. That's a side note. What does salvation do? They talk like Jesus. Salvation talks like Jesus. My first point was, what does salvation talk like? My second point was, what does salvation look like? What does salvation look like? Now, what does a saved person look like to you? Can they look like anything special? They look like anybody else? What do they look like? Just an average person, right? They don't suddenly become this beaming light, right? They're just a saved person. But somebody who's saved, they have characteristics that are separate from the world, and you can tell by looking at them. When Paul, in the New Testament, wherever he was going and sharing the gospel, people wanted to know, they said, something's different about that man. When the Pharisees saw Jesus, they said, something's different about that man. He was different. We are called to be set apart. We are called to look different. We don't look like the world. We don't talk like the world, and we don't look like the world. In 2 Corinthians, it tells us how we should look. Let me find it real quick, and we will read it together. 2 Corinthians 5:17. says this, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, and see, the new has come. We don't live in our old self. We don't live in the old sin. Now, the person who got saved, are they perfect? No. Are they sinless? No, right? So they're not perfect, they're not sinless, but they look different. Well, how do they look different? It's because sometimes in our life, something has to die. All throughout the scriptures, when something dies, they related death to seeing, death to sight. Sometimes the things in our life have to die. We have to give up sin and say, God, I'm going to live for you. When I surrendered my life, it was hard to quit drinking, but I said, that has to die, and I gave it up. When I wanted to go out to bars all the time, I said, that has to die so I can be a good dad, so I can be a good husband, so I can be a godly man. That has to die. Sin in our life has to die. We can't keep going back to it. And I think this is a perfect example. So one of the girls almost, like she almost got it exactly when I was asking him. I said, what do you think this is for? And she's like, I think it's probably this. And she almost got it exactly. But this picture represents, if y'all can see it, let me slide over here. Can all y'all see that? Okay, cool. So this picture right here represents us. And all of these ping pong balls in here represent sin in our life, okay? Whether that's gossiping, drinking, looking at things we know we shouldn't look at, doing things with your girlfriend or boyfriend you know you shouldn't do. This represents sin, right, in our life. People in the back, can y'all see the ping pong balls? Can y'all see them? Okay, it's pretty easy to see, right? See, when somebody is unchurched, living in sin, full of sin, it's pretty easy to see you're living in sin. It's pretty easy. But see, the church, we like to say, well, I went to church and I said a prayer. I didn't mean the prayer, but I said a prayer. And now I'm changed. I go right back to living my life just like I was before. Nothing changed. Didn't mean the prayer. Just went to church. And I felt God speaking to me, but I wasn't ready to surrender. Happened to me. I prayed and asked God to save me, and I did not mean it at all. I just felt God tugging on me, and I wanted something to change, but I wanted to be in control of my life. This is that person, full of sin. So they go to church, they say a prayer, and nothing changes. Well, then somebody's like, hey, didn't you get saved? Didn't you say that prayer? Why you still all got all this sin in your life that everyone can see? So they're like, ooh, everyone can see my sin, and I got to get rid of it. So we get really good, and we're like, okay, let me hide that. A little bit better. So instead of being changed, we just rearranged our sin and hit it a little bit better. Can y'all see that back there? Is good. Can y'all still see some ping pong balls? Right. Little harder to see, but y'all can see them, right? See, we think in the modern day church and in modern day Christianity, we think that's salvation. We think that's what salvation looks like. We have set the bar so low in modern day church and modern day Christianity, that to the detriment of new believers in Christ and non-believers in Christ, they think that this is what salvation looks like. You're just like me, you just got better at hiding it. That's what salvation looks like? No, what salvation should look like is the person, I'm gonna lose some ping pong balls here. The person is caught in their sin, they feel remorse for their sin, and they say, God, save me. God, I need you to remove this sin out of my life. I'm struggling with these addictions. And God says, well, I got some grace for you. And he starts pouring this grace in here. And little by little, more and more, we start seeing these ping pong balls fall out until God's grace just keeps flowing over and flowing over and flowing over. Until, is that person perfect? No, it's a whole lot harder to see their sin now, though, right? People look at you and they say, what's different about you? I don't see, you don't do all the same things you used to do. What's different about you? It's God's grace. Surrendering to God, surrendering your life to him and saying, God, I need you. I can't do this without you. What does salvation look like? Salvation is different. Salvation is change. Salvation doesn't look like the rest of the world. We don't go back to our sin over and over and over again. You say, but I said a prayer. And then you go right back to that sin. I asked God to forgive me. I went right back to that sin. I asked God to forgive me. I went right back to that sin. I asked God to forgive me. I went right back to that sin. That's not what salvation is. God saved us so we could live a victorious life. Salvation is change. So what does salvation talk like? What does salvation look like? Salvation looks like change. I want the person in here, the person who's the new believer in Christ, or the person who's saying, I have a lot of friends around me that say they believe in God, but I don't know what is real. I want to speak to that person, because we're used to seeing the people who hide all their ping pong balls in the frosted pitcher and say, hey, look, that's salvation. And you guys are saying, I don't know what's right. They look like me, they walk like me, but they go to church. They look like me, they walk like me, but they're at the same parties I am. They're doing the exact same things I'm doing. Those people are struggling and looking for someone to follow. Those people, I want to address y'all today. I want you guys to look and follow after Christ. I want you to open your Bible and say, God, show me, who am I supposed to follow after? Well, it's simple. You're supposed to follow after Christ. That's who it's supposed to be. Christ said, pick up your cross and follow me. He will never lead you astray. Don't worry about following these other people, these fake Christians. Follow him. Follow him. My first point was, what does salvation talk like? My second point was, what does salvation look like? My third and final point is, what does salvation walk like? And we're going to read Ephesians 4:1. Let me flip over to it. Therefore, I, the prisoner in the Lord, urge you to walk worthy of the calling you have received. To walk worthy of the calling you have received. God has placed a calling on your life. When you receive salvation, God has you saved for a purpose. If you weren't saved for a purpose, God would have immediately called you into heaven. You would have been in heaven, and you would not have been left on this earth. You have a purpose. Salvation walks with a purpose. When you receive Christ, you have a purpose, and that is to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's what we're here to do. Now, it looks different for each and every person. How I'm led to share the gospel of Jesus Christ and what God has in my purpose can be completely different than somebody else in this room, but we still have the same purpose of furthering God's kingdom and sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. There's a common thread there, a common theme. But the Christian walk can look a little different. It can be a little different, right? So, you know what? I think I'm gonna do a demonstration of the Christian walk, and I'm gonna get some volunteers. I'm gonna use some cones. I'm going to use some volunteers. Does anybody want to volunteer? Does anybody want to? No? I want you to know. So I'm going to get Papa. I'm going to pick him. Ooh, I need somebody else. You want to? All right, come on. Come on. Come on, EJ. All right, here. You can stay right here. I'll come down here with you. Let me get this ping pong while I drop before I get in trouble. All right. Okay, so you're going to represent a new believer in Christ, okay? New believer. I want you to switch sides. You're going to stand over here and you swap over here. Hang on. Here you go. I want you to stand right here by that cone. Okay. You stand by that cone. All right. New believer in, we're going to go back a step before you're a new believer. You're about to surrender your life. It's so good. You can't wait. Papa, I'm so sorry. You're the devil. My bad. my bad, brother. Appreciate you volunteering. So my man EJ here, he is lost, living in his sin, right? Look how far the devil is away from him. Sorry. Look how far the devil is away from him. He doesn't care about him, right? He don't care. Why? Because he doesn't need to care about him. He's lost in his sin. He's living in sin, right? Here you go. I'll take that cone. I want you to set it down at your feet. So EJ gets saved, surrenders his life to Christ. Now you stay there. Now listen. I want you to do. I want you to walk down there and I want you to get right in his face. Get right in his face, okay? Okay, so now the devil gets right in EJ's face. Why does he care? Because he just surrendered his life. So right here, he says, what are you doing? Why did you surrender your life? You're just going to fall right back into that sin. Why would you do this? He's all up in your face. And EJ's like, oh man, what do I do? But then he remembers what the Bible says, resist the devil and he will flee from you. So I want you just to brush your shoulder like that. Just brush it. So he brushed his shoulder. Now you got to go back over there, devil. He resisted you. I'm sorry. So you hold the cones. You hold the cones. I'll give them to you. You can keep using them. Here, step over here. So step out of that moment in time right here. Go ahead and put a cone down right here. So he steps out of this moment. this previous moment becomes part of his testimony. All right? Now he steps into this new moment. And this new moment, devil, come on over here, get in his face. And this new moment, he just got saved. All right? Now he goes and tells his friends, and all his so-called friends he thought would be happy for him, make fun of him, talk about him behind his back. They don't care. He feels like he's all alone. He feels like he has nobody. And he wants to go back to those parties and be back in the in crowd. He wants to do those things. But then, EJ, he remembers what the Bible says. What does it profit a man to gain the whole world but lose your own soul? So he brushed the devil off his shoulder. He brushed the devil off. Devil, you got to go back over there. So EJ steps out of that moment into his next moment right there. Go ahead and put that cone down. So now he's in his new moment. The previous moment becomes part of his testimony, right? Becomes part of his testimony. So he steps into this new season of life. Come on over here. So the devil couldn't distract you. He couldn't defeat you. So now he tries to mess with EJ's relationship. So now he's like, EJ, look, I mean, you and your girl, you've been together for a long time. You know, he tries to get them to do things they shouldn't do. For the married couples in here, he's trying to get you guys to cheat on your spouse. He's trying to get you to look at something you know you shouldn't look at. He's trying to get you to have that inappropriate conversation with the opposite sex at work. He's trying to get you to do those things. Teenagers, he's trying to get you to send that Snapchat, to send that text, to do those things you know you shouldn't do. And you're sitting here and you're like, oh my goodness, what should I do? Should we do this? Should we not? I mean, I think I might marry her. I don't know. But then he remembers what the Bible says, and it says flee from sexual immorality. So he brushes the devil off his shoulder. Go ahead and brush him off his shoulder. Okay, you step back over there. So step out of that moment into your next moment right there. Go ahead and put that cone down right there. So this previous moment now becomes what? Part of his testimony, right? He steps into the new season, the new moment of his life. Now, this moment, the devil comes at him. Now, listen, I want you to get all up in his face. I want you to put your arms around him like this. I want your nose to touch his nose, okay? All right. So the devil comes at you, gets you with everything you got. He's all around you, okay? Right here in this moment, he tries to make you doubt yourself. He tries to disqualify. He couldn't distract you. He couldn't defeat you. He couldn't weigh on your relationship. He tries to disqualify you right here in this part of your life, in this part of your season. He wants EJ to feel like he can't do nothing right in his life. And EJ feels like it's coming from all around him. He can't even hear the Lord. He doesn't know what he's going to do. This is where shame and condemnation and guilt reside. EJ's struggling right here. And just when he's about to throw in the towel, he remembers what the Bible says. And what's that? What's it say? It says, he who is free indeed. And he's like, I'm saved. I'm renewed. So he brushed the shoulder. Go ahead and brush the devil off your shoulder. Go ahead. Now you got to go back over there. Look. Now, EJ, step right here between these two cones. Now, EJ is right here. He's about to step into the promise that God has given him. That's the promise he's been growing him towards, all of these things that he's been going through in his life. This is where the promise of, hey, you're going to be serving Christ. You're going to go on that mission trip. You're going to share the gospel with your friend, with your coworker. You're going to be what I promised and grew you to make you to be. And the devil can't stand it. Because one thing, I want you to get in his face again. One thing that the devil hates more than you surrendering your life is you trying to lead other people to Christ. Right? That's the one thing he hates more. And he's all around you. You're ready to throw in the towel. You can't even hear God. You're worried. So you're worried about giving up. And then God reminds you. He takes you back. Stay here. You come on over here. Come on over here. I want you to come back over here to the first moment. God brings you all the way back. Now, when I say I remember when, I want you to grab that cone, okay? I remember when. Every time I say it, when I say it, we're going to move over, okay? I remember when. So he remembers when he was lost in his trespasses and sin, and God saved him and pulled him out of it. And the devil said, oh, it would be better to do that. And he said, no, and he resisted him, and his life was better. Step over here. He says, I remember when I lost all my friends, and they all left me, but then God gave me new friends. He gave me true friends. He gave me better friends. God brought me out of that. Come on over here. He says, I remember when I wanted to do things with my girlfriend or my boyfriend. I wanted to send that text, that Snapchat, and I knew I shouldn't do it. And I know that I don't find myself worth in that. I find myself worth in Christ, and I resisted him. Step over here. And he says, I remember when everything was all around me and I couldn't see. I didn't know which way was up. I didn't know what to do. And the devil was trying to disqualify me. And God showed me step by step everything he did. And then you stand here in front of the devil and you say, the thing between me and you is God. The best way to trap the enemy is to resurrect a testimony. The best way to defeat the enemy is to resurrect a testimony. That's how to walk like you're Christian. That's how to walk like you're saved. Thank you. Y'all can sit down. Y'all did amazing. You were a great devil. Do you have a testimony? Have you been saved? Do you walk like you're saved? See, in the modern church, we like to pretend a lot. And that's a cute, funny word, ha ha, pretend. But it's serious. We like to pretend to be saved. We like to fake it till we make it. But the truth is, you won't make it. Because what's going to happen is we're going to go to heaven and we're going to stand before an almighty God and we're going to hear the most horrible, the most wretched words we could ever hear, ever uttered, is he's going to look at you and say, "Depart from me, you workers of iniquity, I never knew you." And you're going to say, "But God, I was in a youth group. Depart from me. But God, I was a deacon. Depart from me. But God, I preached. Depart from me. But God, I went to church every Sunday, Monday, Wednesday, every day of the week. God, the doors were open. I was there. Depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I never knew you." The most horrid words you could ever hear uttered on the face of the earth. Depart from me. I never knew you. You see how serious it is to pretend? Pretend to be saved? To pretend? All you are is misleading people around you. But you're not misleading the Lord. He looks past our words. He looks straight to our heart, to the desires of our heart. And he knows what's true and real. Do you talk, look, and walk like a Christian? Or are you just pretending? Do you have a testimony? Or are you just a phony? That might be a sermon one day. Do you look like you're saved? Do you talk like you're saved? Do you walk like you're saved? Have you been saved? Have you surrendered your life? Or did you just say a prayer you didn't mean? I want to know. If you're in here today and you say, "God, I don't know if I've been saved. God, I said a prayer. God, I haven't said a prayer. I don't know if I've been saved. But I want to know." In just a moment, this altar is going to be for you. If you're in here and you're saying, "God, I'm in one of those seasons that Jake was just talking about. I'm in one of those seasons. And I need God's protection. I need God's wisdom. I need him to speak to me. I need him to show me because I feel like the enemy's all around me. I don't know which way to go. I'm ready to throw in the towel." This altar's for you. If you're in here and you have a friend that's going through something, this altar's for you. So many times we look at this altar related to condemnation, to guilt, to shame. It's for victory. Victory out of your sin, victory out of your problem, victory out of your lust. It's victory. And it starts right here. If you're in here and you're lost and you want to be saved, come down here and grab my hand. Grab a friend's hand and come down here. Grab anybody in here. I don't care. Come down here and get it right. Let's get saved. If you're in here and you're going through a season and you want me to pray with you, I'll be glad to pray with you. If you just want to pray about it, come down here. Let's get it right. Let's pray about it. Everyone stand. Let me pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for all your many blessings. Lord, thank you for what you're doing in this place. Lord, I pray that you just move in this place. Lord, I pray for the person that's in here. Lord, I know they're in here. Lord, I pray for that person that's lost. That as I'm speaking right now, is saying, "God, I know I'm lost. But I said a prayer, God, I know I'm lost. But I'm part of a youth group, God, I know I'm lost." Lord, I pray that you just draw them and convict them. Draw them to the altar. Lord, bring them to me. I would love to share how you could change their life like you changed mine. Lord, to the people that are in here that are struggling, Lord, I pray that you just move in their life. Lord, I pray that you bless them and strengthen them. Lord, I pray that your perfect will would be done in their life. Lord, I pray that you move during this time. In Jesus' name, amen. Y'all come.
back, it leads us to repentance. And it's so bright, the darkness has to flee.
Yeah.
Hallelujah, it cleared my guilty sentence. For I was bound, but now I stand redeemed. For what could break the chains of any prison? What force could rob the power from the grave? And what would trade my rags for heaven's riches?
What is it?
Oh God, how I need you.
you guys. Thank you. Y'all can be seated. Thank y'all so much for y'all's attentiveness and my volunteers. Papa, thank you for being the devil. I appreciate you, my man. God is moving. God is doing big things, but I want y'all to be thinking, what can we do to serve him? What can I do to talk, look, and walk like a Christian? God, how can I serve you? I don't want to just be a pew warmer. I don't want to just be a youth group guy or girl that sits here and does nothing. God, what can I do to serve you? God, what's my purpose? God, show me, grow me. How can I serve you? That's what I want our outlook to be as a church, as a youth group, as a community. That's what we should have. God, how can I serve you? I heard a preacher say this. He said, whenever you're asking God of what you should do, the best thing you can do is just put your yes on the table, no matter what it is. And he said, when I put my yes on the table, I ended up going to another country and sharing the gospel. But he said, I just put my yes on the table. So I want y'all to be thinking, God, how can I serve you? And just put your yes on the table and say, God, seek his face and say, God, what can I do? How can I serve you? How can I serve you in my school? How can I serve you at work? How can I serve you in my community? How can I serve you at my home and tell my family about you? How can I tell my friends about you? God, I'm going to put my yes on the table, and I'm going to serve you. That's it. I'm going to pray, and we'll be dismissed. Thank y'all so much for being here and coming out tonight. I'll pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for all your many blessings. Lord, thank you for what you're doing in our church and in our youth group, Lord. I pray that your perfect will is done, Lord, in our lives. I pray that you bless each and every person in here, Lord. And for that one that's lost, Lord, that's needing you, Lord, I pray that they find me, they find Amber, they find somebody after the service, and they ask how they can be saved, Lord. Lord, I pray that each person has Traveling Mercies home, and I pray that you keep them safe. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to sing like Silas tearing down the prison walls. I want to face that fire. It won't burn me though. God's got my back, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego. I want to walk like Moses right through the waves. One day I'll see that promised land no longer slave.